Shalom, and welcome to Ve'ahavta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at LoveIsrael.org. That's one word, LoveIsrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
When a person begins to read the New Covenant, and of course I'm speaking about what's also called the New Testament, that person will find very quickly that Yeshua, Jesus of Nazareth, that he did numerous miracles. And why did he do so many miracles? Simply to meet needs? This is not what the Word of God reveals. These miracles that Yeshua did, they were for the purpose of instruction. They provided insight, revelation, in order that we might understand more about his identity and also his work. And why is that important? Because it's only when you have identified who he is, the Son of God, properly, and you understand why he was sent into this world, then and only then can you respond to this truth and do so in a way that is going to bring into your life eternal blessing. The Word of God reveals truth in order that we might receive from God, and by receiving from God that we become a new creation, thereby able to serve him and bring honor and glory to him. Take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Matthew and chapter 17. The book of Matthew and chapter 17. Now in verse 14, we're going to see something that's unusual. And we're also going to see a passage that deals with demonic influence and also the judgment of God. And do you realize that there is a relationship between these two things, demonic activity and the judgment of God? What we're going to learn in our study is this: demons work in this world. They attack individuals. They influence them for a purpose, to move you away from the things of God, in order that in disobedience, because of a rejection of the truth, or simply being unaware of God's revelation, that you will become a recipient of God's judgment, his wrath. That is what delights the enemy. And I'm speaking about Satan and those demons that serve him. Now, look, if you would, to this 14th verse I mentioned. There's something that's unusual, because normally we have seen in several places in this Gospel of Matthew that there are large crowds of individuals, and these crowds are pursuing Messiah. They are following after him. But here, it's quite different. Verse 14, and they came to the crowd. See the difference? Here they, and we're going to see they being Yeshua and his disciples, they came to the crowd and a man. And this man is one of insight. This man took opportunity in the right way. So let me ask you a question. Are you? When you have an opportunity in your life, when God makes available to you something, are you wise enough? Are you humble enough to respond to that as he would have you to do so? And in doing so, become a recipient of God's good work, his edifying influence in your life. This man's going to do just that. And he's a wise man because he understands the identity of Yeshua. And that is something that the vast majority of the world is confused about. They do not know him as they should. And they do not give him the emphasis that he demands. So once more, we read here that a man coming to him, what did he do? He is kneeling to him. This is this man kneeling before Yeshua and saying, Lord. Now pay attention to that word, Lord. Now, some will tell you that this word, and this is true, it does not necessarily have to do with the Lord God Almighty. It can be a term of great respect, like sir. But make no mistake about it, in this passage of Scripture, it is referring to just that, God. This man who comes, and notice what it says that he did. It says, kneeling. And this kneeling shows an identification of the identity of Messiah. That he's not just a miracle worker, that he's not just a teacher, not just a prophet, but he is the Son of the living God. And therefore, this man comes humbly, kneeling before Yeshua. And notice what he says, verse 15. And saying, Lord, have mercy on my son. Now, what I want to emphasize is what the passage does. And that is this man's beseeching, requesting in great sincerity for God's mercy to be upon his son. Let me share with you a very important biblical truth. And if you stumble over this, you're not aware of it, you don't apply it to your life, you will have eternal regret. Because mercy is what we need. If we don't experience God's mercy, make no mistake, we will not experience the goodness of God. God's work in a person's life begins with mercy. So I say this frequently, but it's so important. When was the last time you came in prayer before God, beseeching him for mercy? And mercy, understand the nature of this word. In the Hebrew language, and this, of course, is Greek, but there's a correlation. In the Hebrew language, mercy has to do with that which is supplied, given, becomes available, and the outcome is a restoration, and here's the key, to God's purpose, God's plan. So when someone says, God, be merciful to me, many times we only associate that with a request of forgiveness. And it can relate to forgiveness, but more often than not, when we look at the context, it has to do with a restoration. And this is certainly the case here. And this man who humbly comes before Yeshua, identifying him as Lord, he says to him, be merciful to my son. And the question we have to ask ourselves is, why is that? Well, he explains. Continue on in verse 15. Because he is, and your Bible might say a person that has some disease like epilepsy. You might see it as someone who is a lunatic. The word has to do with being struck by the moon, which is an idiom for simply not being in one's own control. He has influence upon him that controls his life. And that is a very dangerous position to be in. Now, we're going to see an extreme example of that. But that same disease, that same spiritual condition can afflict individuals to a lesser degree. But here's what I want you to see. It can still have the same effect. So pay close attention to what the Word of God is revealing in this passage. This man says concerning his son, he says that he is struck by the moon, meaning he's not in control of himself. And notice the outcome. He, and most translations do not say this, but the word is kakos, which is related to evil. And here we would say evilly suffers. Now, what does that mean? Most Bibles say he suffers greatly, he suffers miserably. But if we pay attention to the original language in the Greek, this word kakos has to do with something that is in conflict with God's will. Meaning this, what this man is experiencing, and he's a young man, we'll see this in a moment. This man's son is an adolescent, and what he's going through is causing him great suffering, intense, exceedingly, in the worst sense. Why? Well, notice what we can derive from this text. And remember, Scripture is written for the purpose of revelation, that we might learn the truth of God and apply that truth to our life. So this man, he is under an influence that causes him not to be able to behave as he would like. He's not in control of himself. And we see as we continue on that this man says, and frequently, literally, for frequently, he falls into fire and frequently into water. Now, when you see fire and water, what we learn is this. These two elements, fire and water, oftentimes, frequently in the Word of God, relates to judgment. We're going to see in an undeniable way what is causing this young man to fall into fire or to fall into water. Now think. Here he is walking, there's fire and that force, and we'll see that it's demonic in a moment. The Word of God emphatically, clearly says that. So this demonic influence pushes him, moves him into fire. He has been burnt how? Frequently. And likewise, it cast him into water in order to try to drown him. And just think about the father seeing his son suffer in such a way. And now this father, wisely, in faith, he comes seeking assistance. And what does he want? He wants the order of God for his son. So important. If you're not seeking God's order in your life, don't even bother to pray. You are foolish. You are still in rebelliousness. If you want anything else other than the order of God. And that's why he pleaded for mercy to be upon his son. And he reveals the problem of what's going on, that he's frequently cast, falls into fire, falls into water. Verse 16, this man still speaks, addressing Yeshua. And he says to him, and I brought him to your disciples, and they were not able him to heal. Now, the order is important because the fact that it does not say they were not able to heal him, that's how most Bibles render it. But in the original language, it says it differently. And this change of what we would expect the order to be reveals to us that the word him is emphatic. The disciples, now they had done miracles previously, but on this occasion, in this situation, they were not able to bring about, and here's the key, they were not able to bring about deliverance. They could not bring a restoration back to God's intended purpose, that young man to be in the state that God wanted him to be in. So this man says, I brought him to your disciples, and they were not able him to heal. Verse 17. But, and this shows in contrast to the inability of the disciples, there's going to be a change. Yeshua is now going to oversee. He is going to act. He is going to respond. And therefore, we read in verse 17, but Yeshua answered, he said, and pay great attention to these words, O faithless and perverted generation. Now, this word faithlessness has to do with being opposed to faith. And what this word speaks of is someone who is not submitting to truth because, and hear this carefully, because he's really not interested in the will of God. When someone is faithful, therefore his desire, his purpose is going to be related to the will of God. He will want to obey the will of God. He will want the will of God to be realized in his life or her life. So we read in this passage, Messiah says concerning that generation, that they are against truth, they are against faith. They're not interested in the will of God, and they are, in this next word, it can mean perverted, it can mean distorted, it can mean that which is corrupted. It's a turning away from, once more, the purpose of God. So constantly, daily, many times throughout the day, you and I need to do something. We need to pray. We need to ask the Holy Spirit to examine ourselves in order that we check and see if truly we're pursuing the will of God, that we are committed to the purposes of God. And realize there is no better place to be than doing just that. In God's will, motivated by his truth, enlightened by his word, and committed to his purposes, walking in obedience to his will. Now realize, God does not need anything. God is perfect. He is complete. He needs nothing from us. And everything that he instructs us to do, we do it to honor him, to glorify him, but realize something. It is in the long run, from a kingdom perspective, it is in our best interest. It is always, 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 hear that. It is always the right thing to do for you to submit to God. There might be some unpleasant experience initially, but once one enters into the kingdom of God, I assure you, promise you, none of those people who were committed to God's will, that carried out his purpose, that walked in obedience to his will, none of them have any regrets. And when you submit, you carry out the things of God, God responds. And he will supernaturally give you an inner tranquility. You will have what Paul says, that peace that passes all understanding. You will have contentment. And you know what else you'll have? Really, what everyone's seeking. And that is a joy and a happiness. And that only comes when one is in the will of God. And you may be suffering. And that's why Paul says he's learned the secret. How to be content, that peace that he receives from God, and that word peace is related to the fulfillment of God's will, that he's learned and experienced that peace that passes all understanding, meaning this, you can have that peace and the world doesn't understand how. You may be suffering, you may be going through trials and tribulations, you may be under the attack of the enemy, but that enemy, when you are walking in the will of God, that enemy cannot take away your joy. God has given it, and it will remain with you. So Messiah, he scolds this generation, calling it faithless and also perverted or corrupt. And he continues, until when will I be with you? Until when will I suffer? This is a word of tolerant. When, how long will I be tolerating this type of faithlessness and disobedience? Finally, he says, end of verse 17, you bring to me him here. Always the emphasis in this passage is on this young man, this father's son. Every time Yeshua speaks, he emphasizes this one. And here's the key. It's when we think like Yeshua thinks, when we put first what Yeshua puts first, then we're going to have that anointing, that power is going to be released, and God's will is going to be carried out. Verse 18, Yeshua begins by rebuking him. Now, this rebuking, it's interesting because this word rebuking, a scolding, it's so significant that it comes from two Greek words, timeo and epi. Timeo is basically a word that speaks of value or honor or that which is esteemed, and epi is upon. So the rebuke is not just words, but this rebuking comes with Messiah taking honor, that which is esteemed. And this is related to the kingdom of God and placing it upon this young man. And it's that act, this act of rebuking. Note it says, and he rebuked him. Who's that? Yeshua. Yeshua rebuked him, and the demon went out from him. Now we have it. Undeniably, what was this young man's problem? It was a demon. Now, if you're a believer, a demon can never, ever, ever possess you. A demon can never enter into you because you are a temple where the Holy Spirit dwells. But be careful, because believers can be afflicted. We can find ourselves being opposed by demonic influence. But remember this wonderful promise, and that's this. The one who is in us, the Holy Spirit, the very Spirit of God, the Spirit of Yeshua, Jesus Christ, he dwells in us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. And therefore, we have, if we submit, if we listen to the leadership of the Holy Spirit, his conviction, his illumination, his truth, we are going to be, and I love this word, overcomers. That's what you are called to be, an overcomer. But realize that implies that there's things that you have to overcome. So once more, the demon went out from him, and the man, this young man, was healed from that hour. Now, it doesn't say he was healed at that hour, but from that hour. What does that mean? That this work of restoration, this work of Messiah, just didn't have an effect at that moment and then wore off. Things came back and was back as they were. No, no, and no. This phrase means from that moment on. When Yeshua brings about a change, he brings about, hear this, eternal change. And he is the one that brings about deliverance from the influence of the enemy, that evil one. Because, and I want to repeat this, what does the enemy want from you? He derives, and I'm speaking about Hasatan, Satan, he derives pleasure, satisfaction, in seeing an individual whom God loves, whom Messiah died for, but that individual that neglected the truth of God, rejected the gospel of God, Satan And demonic influence is all about acting in a way that positions you for what? The judgment of God. And it's only Yeshua himself that's able to bring about an eternal change for you. Verse 19. Then the disciples, they came to Yeshua by themselves. They said, why were we not able to cast him, referring to that demon, why were we not able to cast him out? Verse 21. But Yeshua. Now he's showing something in contrast to his disciples. They're saying, why weren't we able? Here's the message. Let me give you an example. One of the things that Daniel did, and one of the things that Joseph, the son of Jacob in Egypt, these two men in exile, they did something. They were great interpreters of dreams. And what did they say? Oh, we don't interpret dreams, but we know the God who does. And God, he will give me that interpretation. See, the problem was the disciples were saying, why couldn't we cast them out? It's not us. It's the Holy Spirit in us. And that's why he says, now look, if you would, to verse 20. But Yeshua said to them, on account, and once more, if you are having a modern translation, it will say, because of little faith. But the Textus Receptus has that same word that's used earlier, and that is that which is against faith, that which is against the truth. They didn't have the same purpose, the same objective of Messiah. So he says, on account of your faithlessness, for truly I say to you, and this is a great verse, Messiah is making a promise. Now, we're going to pick up with this promise next week. But let me introduce it by saying you don't want to miss next week's study. Because it speaks about a power of prayer, a power of fasting that brings about that which is impossible in the natural sense. It is what brings about a glorious change in your life, in your situation, and allows you to minister, to be used by God in order to bring about changes, to have a faith, and here's the key, to have a faith that is able to move a mountain. Better yet, the mountain. And if you don't know what I mean, join us next week. Shalom from Israel.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of LoveIsrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, LoveIsrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.